I found something down in Antarctica that I think is pretty amazing, and I wanted to share it with you guys today. The reason we're here looking at this pyramid is it's a South American step pyramid. They worshipped a god, a deity that they believed was a winged serpent named Kukulcan. And I'm sure a lot of you, if you've watched all of the alien shows, the History Channel stuff, you're very familiar with this paradigm. Another reason we're looking at this is some of these pyramids, I'm not sure if this one in particular is the one, but they're aligned and built in such a way that when the sun goes down on a certain day, the way the shadows are cast, it looks like a stairway or some type of a ribbed spine on one side that slowly progresses upward or downward depending on the time of year and where you're looking at it. So, given that we know at one time things like this existed, this is of course pterodactyl. This is a representation of Archaeopteryx, another large bird. The myriad stories of the phoenix. This is Thoth. This is the Egyptian god that had the head of a bird. And given some anecdotal evidence from things that have been reported around recently and in modern times, a lot of which are fake or just misinterpretations, there are stories of people encountering incredibly large birds. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with the fake CGI one of the bird that swooped through the park and grabbed up the kid, and it was really well done. It was the best CGI fake, I think, ever. But I had a bit of a personal experience myself some years ago, and it was a bird that was on the ground in Panama in the jungle. Now, I didn't tell anyone about this because I was Army intelligence, and you don't go yammering on about crypto creatures without risking losing your security clearance. But I wasn't alone, and we both shut up about it. And this thing had a beak as long as my rifle. It had eyes that were bigger around than a human fist. And now it wasn't flying, but based on its size, it looked like it had a wingspan, easy 30, 35 feet plus. And we just backed away slowly and went the other way. It was no joke. Now, very much like this, a bird that science has established lived a long time ago, and while there have not been any living examples of this captured, it's very clear that something this large did live. Now, this is called Argentavis magnificens, after, of course, Argentina. Argentina is the country closest to Antarctica. 6 million years ago, wingspan around 21 feet, feathers as long as samurai swords. This is real close to what I saw. It was dark. I didn't get a real good look. We didn't stick around for a long time. And it was, like I said, 25 years ago. So, what I'm about to show you next is pretty amazing. You have to remember that in this region, there are these large pictographs where they created these structures in Peru that you could only see what they were if you were flying above at altitude. And they've established these in a lot of these, and you can see the two on the right here. This one up here, of course, is of a bird, and this one down here is of a bird. So, without any further ado, I want to show you what looks like a pictograph created on the side of a mountain of people worshiping a great bird. I don't think I even have to point it out. We clearly have what looks like the feathers here, the giant wings getting ready to take off, the head with the mouth open, the feet perched here, and then down here we have what looks very clearly like a human being kneeling, its hands in prayer, wearing some type of a headdress. There's also a second bird here without its wings being, you know, like it's ready to fly. It's pretty, I mean, it's beyond coincidence. I mean, we have established that this is what people in South America, Peru, Argentina, Chile did. They created these massive pictographs that you could only see if you were flying above, and they worshipped birds. And here, down in Antarctica, the country that, or the, excuse me, the continent closest to Argentina, where Argentavis magnificens was found, what do we see? On the side of a mountain, and I'll give you the link, of course, the coordinates here. You see what looks like a carved picture of a giant bird with its beak open, its wings here, as if it's ready to take off. Another bird here, looking directly over a human being right here that is clearly kneeling. You can even see the feet. Here's the feet. You know, here's the knees, the thighs, the body, the arms out in front. Looks like it's maybe giving an offering. And there might have been something here that it's very hard to see, but it looks like right here there could be some kind of a representation of something heavenly. I'm sure a lot of you can probably, who studied this a lot more than I have, tell me what this is. And it's almost, if you look at it even closer a little bit, it looks like there might even be a smaller bird in a nest here above where I've put the pin. So this is a very clear, to me, unmistakable representation that perhaps the people in Antarctica, this ancient civilization that we've established, had some type of a bird as a god. I mean, it's over and over and over again throughout history that we have seen this on multiple continents. Evidence in the geologic record for these large birds, visual evidence for them, written evidence for them being worshipped. And here we see three pretty unmistakable images. You know, this one up here, it just, I mean, you don't even have to be close. You don't even have to be zoomed in to see this. You can very clearly what they did here. That this was, and of course, it's on a hillside. On a hillside that very oddly looks like at one time it might have not have been just a hillside. So, like I said, I will give you guys the location for this. You can look at it for yourself, but it's, at least from my interpretation, pretty unmistakable. When you put it up next to what we've established, is clearly evidence for this type of thing. Now, there are a couple other things down there that I wanted to show you guys. In this very region, I had mentioned about the pyramid that had the kind of the rib side to it. Well, right next to it, where this is, you see what looks like this giant spine that leads right up to this. And like I said, here's our worshiping figure. Here's the bird. Right here, here's the other bird. And like I said, you look at this even from this angle. It's not a perspective trick of the eye. And you have this structure that would mimic greatly what they tried to do with the pyramid up in Peru. And like I said, I just have it labeled first thing that came to mind. This is giant bent spine. And like I said, you can zoom out and you can see this from a great distance. I mean, this would be a great way to, you know, any craft flying over, you know, it would represent that the people here, you know, worship birds. You know, if you're the bird god, come bless us, whatever, you know, their intent was. Who knows? But one other thing I wanted to cover is, oh, let me see if I can show you guys this. It's something else I think they captured and didn't mean to capture. What looks like in this, like I said, not very far from this, a very large creature, two-legged creature walking up the side of this hill. As you can see, there's the legs. Looks like it has something over its back, the head, and it's walking up the side of this mountain. Now, I don't know if this isn't a representation like the other, or if this is just the imagery creating a two-dimensional picture of a three-dimensional object. It's hard to say. But the coloration is very different than the rock around it. It's much darker, much more pronounced. And that's why it was able to be seen from such a high altitude as not just part of the rock. We've covered this before as well, and this is just another example of it. Right here, there is this strange shadow, and it's got kind of a round shape to it, cylinder shape to it. But when you zoom in very closely, once again, we see a shape much like the Baltic Sea anomaly. It's rounded, it comes to a point, and then it has this straight line cut right in the center. And in case anybody doesn't know what the Baltic Sea anomaly is, I had brought up a picture of it. Here it is. This is, of course, an artist's representation. This is the original. Let's see if I can get this to pop up here. The original sonar image from 2011. And we've shown lots and lots of these all over Antarctica. The reason I brought up this picture here is it shows they were able to somehow down there build these structures. No mortar, the pieces fit together so perfectly, you can't even slide a piece of paper in between them. And it's a baffling thing. I know a lot of you have probably seen the stories. The guy with the crazy hair, long Greek name, talks about this. And when you look at this, and you go back to Antarctica, and you look around, and I know a lot of people say, well, just the volcanoes do this kind of stuff naturally. There is really, no way you could possibly believe that. Because here, you can see virtual perfect fit like you do there. Now, this is, of course, something that's being used for some type of a channel or walkway. As those are walls, they must have to have been made differently. This particular thing that I found is kind of hard to see because it's very small, but it sticks out. There's something purple glowing in the middle of this round object, in the middle of this basically pavers, what look like pavers. And they could have created stuff like this. It's not beyond the ability of these people. That's why I showed that other wall that we've seen this. Over here, it looks like very clearly there these straight lines look like at one time there was artificial moorings of some type. Whether these are for ground craft or aircraft, or if this was underwater, Watercraft, I don't know. But when you look at this ridge, this perfectly straight ridge, and then you see these perfectly 90 degree lines drawn directly at it, it sticks out as completely unnatural. Science has made this allegation that for there to be life in the universe, the only thing that would be necessary would really be water. Well, here's what looks like some type of a structure, and there's a pathway, a tunnel underground that leads away from it. Now, I don't know what natural structure you could possibly think this is, where this is round. And the reason I preface that is that would it be beyond the realm of possibility of a group of people, for lack of a better term, living beings down here to have existed underground, underneath this ice sheet, for a very, very long time, undetected, given the amount of fresh water from those ice sheets and the known geothermal activity? Very likely there's water underneath there. And if they have water, that's all that science has established is necessary to maintain or create life. Here, we can see something. Now, once again, I have mentioned before, sometimes things get hidden in time, in perspective, and in layers. Now, this is a 2012 photo. We're going to back out here so that we can try to get this to reveal in 2000 in an earlier photo. There we go. All right, this is a 2010 photo. Now, what we see here is what looks like just normal mountaintops. Everything's fine. But right here, we see what looks like a building, a rectangular structure amongst all of these random jagged peaks. Once again, it looks like they've done a poor job of scrubbing whatever that structure was. And then when we look down here, we see what very clearly looks like. We have an edge here, we have an edge here, a pyramid on top of that is, for some reason, you see how the snow is all here, and all for some reason this area is all melted off. That there's something very different about this area. And once again, we see all of this, what look like basically pavers and a stepway up to it. Now, some of this stuff, I'm sure, has degraded over time. And the last thing I'll leave you guys with is this. And I hope I brought the picture up and left it up because I wanted to make the point. We have done so many things. I'll just bring up Google Maps, I guess. Here in the United States, I brought up this rectangle over the western part of Brazil to show you guys something. This area of Brazil is largely unexplored and uninhabited. I brought up a large enough region here. Every person living in the United States right now could have a 1,000 square foot home inside of this region with plenty of room to spare. That's how big this unexplored region of just Brazil is. And it's not even all of Brazil. Is it beyond the realm of possibility to think that maybe there might be an entire civilization down there living underneath that ice, perhaps underground, that we don't know anything about, given how much we don't know just about this part right here in an area of the world that's not that far from us? We've done things in this country, and that's kind of where I was going. Like, for example, with the Mississippi River. There's over 29 major locks and dams on the Mississippi River. Even if we were to disappear today and there wasn't one more thing done by a human being in North America, a visiting civilization from another planet would be able to look down, and even if all the dams had collapsed and were long gone, they would very easily be able to see that at one time there was a civilization here. The Eisenhower Expressway would stick out like a sore thumb. Even overgrown, it would look that way. I think that's a lot of what we're seeing in Antarctica. Is perhaps evidence of a civilization living underground that used to live above ground. And may or may not still be there. But one thing we know all civilizations had in common, no matter how far back you go, is that they all had some kind of a worship type of paradigm. And when you look at this picture, it's very clearly a message to some civilization flying above, just like we saw in Peru. So we'll leave it there, 21 minutes, 20 seconds. But like I said, I'll give you all of these locations and, of course, the year locations, because that's very, very important as well. So you guys have a great weekend. Like, share, subscribe. We'll see you next time.